We're talking with Russell Means, author of Where White Men Fear to Tread, published by St. Martin's Press. Russell, I'm going to hold up a picture of, I believe it's Plymouth Rock on one side and the AIM on the other. Set the scene for what was happening at that time.
Well, with the statue where you can see I'm shouting, that was at Plymouth Rock, and that is the statue of Massasoit, who was the leader of the Wampanoags, who welcomed the pilgrims, fed and clothed them for 2 years, and taught them how to live in this continent and how to plant, harvest, fertilize, etc. The other picture on the opposite page is the siege that they placed upon us at the Native American Embassy, formerly known as the Bureau of Indian Affairs headquarters in Washington, D.C., that we held captive for 7 days during the election week when Nixon was reelected in 1972.
When you write about that in the book, I can understand everything except you say we destroyed the building. And I thought, what did that accomplish?
It accomplished pride and self-dignity. And what happened, and to show, first let me say, we had a sign up there that we left for the news media to look at, because we knew what the news media would do to us after seeing the physical destruction of the Bureau of Indian Affairs and the fact that we took 3 tons of Bureau of Indian Affairs documents with us when we left. That was part of the reason, to cover up the fact that we were spiriting away all these important documents that would expose the BIA. But we said, to build anew, we must destroy the old. We physically put the Bureau of Indian Affairs out of business for over 6 weeks, and nobody missed them. Nobody missed them.
Your organization has been in conflict and competition with them, AIM.
Yes.
What has it accomplished?
Well, cutbacks this year with the Republican Revolution. We have been after the abolition of the Bureau of Indian Affairs since the inception in 1968 of the American Indian Movement, AIM. And for the simple reason, how can any decent thinking human being today, on the eve of the 21st century, allow a colonial office that is only concerned with the ethnicity of one group of people? There is no Bureau of Caucasian Affairs. There's no Bureau of Jewish Affairs. There's no Bureau of African American Affairs. I'm sorry, we are going to have to do something about it.
And the fact that all Indian tribes are not equal, they are individual tribes.
With their sovereign powers, right. And then, and that's the issue that we have retained. But when you set up a colonial system where you force the Indian people to be dependent upon you, like the government has, you create a third world situation.
The gambling. The Indians were given that right to be able to hold gambling casinos on their reservations. What has that income done for the Indian tribes, the population?
Actually, that's the Indian outsmarting the government. The government has, in every instance, we've become economically viable on whatever reservation we may live on in the United States, and there's over 500 Indian land areas. Every time, the Bureau of Indian Affairs has changed policy to knock us back 2 steps so that we never recover economically. Finally, we outsmarted the Bureau of Indian Affairs. We went to them and said, hey, we'd like to start some bingo games to get some revenue for the nation. They said, okay, figuring we'd be like the Catholics. But we outsmarted them. We had bigger gaming stakes, and we do have sovereignty. So we won in court the right to continue to gamble. Because we're separate from the states, the state governments. And they've passed rules and regulations to limit our economic growth through gaming. And now they're after crippling taxes. Not only have they cut back over $250 million, but they plan to, but then they're going to tax us. This is the proposal by the House Ways and Means Committee at a 30% rate.
Russell, in the best of all possible worlds, what would you want to see for the Indian tribes?
Freedom.
Okay, freedom, but what? Better education, better colleges?
Freedom. That's it. Freedom from the United States of America and our right to sit at the table of the family of nations?
Be a little more specific, beginning with when you say freedom, freedom to move off. I mean, you can move off the
freedom
reservation.
From the United States of America. Yes, we can move off the reservation, and unfortunately, we're like the refugees of Vietnam, of Mexico, of Cuba. We are forced to leave because of economic reasons. No Indian would leave our home base if we could viably live there economically. We cannot. We live in enforced poverty. So consequently, we're refugees in our own country. We want freedom. Now, not all of us. There are going to be a lot of Indian reservations that want to keep their hands out and be dependent on the federal government, but not my people. And I'm confident that my reservation and maybe a few others would opt for freedom and the human dignity that goes with it.
Do you believe then that with the vote, with the franchise, you could elect your own people who would go to Congress and, you know, with the vote?
What, nothing to do with Congress. The Demopublicans, I call Washington, D.C. the brick wall. And you go to Washington, D.C. and you bang your head against the brick wall, one of two things happens. Either you say, ouch, that hurt, and so you leave, or else your brains turn to mush. Look at Congress.
I will say that I think the United States government is based on learning compromise in order to move forward.
That's what's the problem. It should be, politics is the art of principles. The art of compromise invites corruption. That's why you have the headlines.
But then it is my way, right or wrong, if you aren't willing to give a little. You found that out.
Give a little? We gave you an hemisphere.
All right. We're now talking about 1996. But you discovered that a little bit, what goes on making a movie. I mean, we should say that the cover is Last of the Mohicans, Pocahontas. You have to give a little in order to get a film made. And maybe that's a metaphor for even government and life.
No, I don't think so. I think you cannot equate Hollywood with the politicians on Capitol Hill. I don't see the correlation there whatsoever.
End result.
Pardon? The end result is that both Hollywood and the politicians fill their pockets full of money, but the politicians do it undercover.
Mm-hmm. I don't totally agree, but that's, again, what makes America sort of not the melting pot you would like, but the fact that we all come and have to share a bit. Now it's Russell Means, Wounded Knee, and William Kunstler, who just passed away. He was an excellent lawyer, because it seemed to me the year of, 1976, you were in and out of trials.
Yes, well, all through the 70s. I went through 13 criminal trials, of which 12 I was my own lawyer. And one of the, or co-counsel. I was co-counsel with Bill Kunstler in my trial about Wounded Knee. Those were thrown out. I wasn't convicted in any case where I was co-counsel or appeared on my own behalf. The only time I wasn't my own lawyer is when I got convicted.
Yeah.
And sent to prison. But it's like my dad said, and he taught me this. Anything bad happens to you, it's your own damn fault. But if you learn from it, then it was good. So nothing bad happened to you.
Very interesting is the situation where you go to that 30 days of learning how to deal with anger. There's a before and after picture of you here. So much of that you could be teaching youngsters because it's such an important lesson.
Oh, yes, the treatment. I've had this rage all my life. And rage, as you may know, is self-destructive.
Yeah.
Not only do you destroy yourself, but you destroy those loved ones that are closest to you. And I've done that, and that's why I like this book. And a lot of reviewers have noticed that also, that the book is honest.
Mm-hmm.
And I do tell a fact that I was a lousy father and a lousy husband. Nevertheless, I faced my responsibilities eventually. But treatment is what saved my life again. But it's one of the many things in my life that the great mystery has guided. Every time I stepped off the good road, the great mystery would put someone or something or some event in that path and push me back onto the good road. And that's what I want to teach young people, that good things happen to good people. if you persevere and your good goals are always paramount, you after those good goals, no matter what happens to you, don't ever lose sight of them, and good things will happen to you.
And along the way, there's a wonderful teacher who made a difference in your life.
Yes. Miss Frithandler or Mrs. Levine?
Yes.
She was really the first major person that came in my life that the great mystery put there that really saved my life. I was on the road to criminality. I was a dope dealer. I was taking dope myself. I was practically gone.
And the worst was you used your little brother.
Right.
Yeah.
However, she stepped in. I fell in love with her, my puppy lip, my first crush. And even when she became Mrs. Levine, the crush remained. You know, I didn't like Mr. Levine, but...
Yeah.
But I had Mrs. Levine, and later on, I knew that she knew I had a crush on her. And she used that crush. After all, she was the only teacher I ever stayed after school for.
Yeah.
But she used that crush to reinstill and reinvigorate my interest in education. And I thought that she was just, and she is, a fantastic human being. She came there exactly at when I needed someone to care about me and to affirm me.
And the final sort of answer to all of us or question when we leave this earth, did your life make a difference?
I look at my children. All 13 of them, and my 18 grandchildren. My children, been through college, they're successful in school, they're very responsible, good children. And then I look at their mothers, the wives that I chose. So I know that I'm a good man. I have good children, and I make good choices.
And you did make a difference. Russell, thank you. I look forward to the future of films and more books. Will you autograph my book for me?
Certainly. Thank you very much.
Thank you. And if you would like a copy of our publication, Good Books, send me a stamped, self-addressed envelope to Good Books, P.O. Box 69-1640, Los Angeles, California, 90069. Support your local library. Go in, take out a card that is how they get funding, and let your congressperson know. Libraries need funding. That's the last place that funds should be cut, because for people who can't afford college, a library can be their own way of learning. And we'll see you next time. Thank you very much, Russell.
Thank you.